So I'm very lucky to have Shireen here with me this evening. Evening in London. It's right now almost half past the hour. Shireen is a dear friend I've known for a long time. She's also the founder of Transparent Publishing Limited. She has also in the past, she has several magazines under her belt. And most importantly here tonight, we're here to discuss the journey she's been through as a cancer survivor. So how are you feeling tonight, Shireen?
Well, hi. Well, thank you very much for this really nice and warm introduction. Yes, me and Nadia go back. She's really a dear friend. I mean, I would say over 20 years. So we were kids and we kind of grew up together. So it's both a privilege to be on an interview here with her, and also it reminds me of our wonderful days in London as well. So it's truly, truly a privilege. Thank you very much for having me here. And please go ahead.
Well, thank you. I think everyone in the audience tonight would like to hear about how it is you discovered you had the cancer and what happened at the moment when you discovered.
Okay. So basically, I'm going to give you just a little bit of background info so you understand that the complete spin and shock that I went through. And obviously a cancer diagnosis at any moment in time is a complete shock, but it's shocking for me, the difference of time and the difference of a situation all in the same moment or the same hour or the same, like a difference between where you were at 1 p.m. and where you become at 3 p.m. on the same day. So basically, I set up my company, Transparent Publishing Limited, in April 2019. And the reason I'm telling you this is because it's always been a dream to set up this publishing house with my business partner, Hossam Hattab. And we set it up, and by the time I came to Friday the 13th, which is ironic, is when I actually went in for my checkup, basically, we had just successfully, distributed and published Faces of Motherhood, issue 1 and 2. We just came out with the Christmas edition. And I was so excited. I spent the night before going to the checkup, up late at night, decorating my Christmas tree. Because for me, I had worked so hard on my business. I'm a stay-at-home mom at the time, and I was married at the time, and so I was raising my son, who's now 7 years old, and basically I used to wake up at 4 a.m. to actually have enough time to work on the magazine, and then at 6:30, 7:30, go and do things. It's just before the publishing dates and manage things while he's in school. So I was so excited for the countdown of Christmas and New Year, because that was the moment that I've been waiting for, that I could look back and say, yes, I did it, and I did it the way I wanted. And then I go to the appointment. I found a lump on my breast a few days before then. I was a bit panicked, but I went to the appointment. And I remember thinking about, I've got the Christmas issues out. It's arrived. I've got my distribution channels, because we did print in the UK. And I was thinking in my head, okay, now, how can I distribute it? What should I do extra beyond that? Blah, blah, blah. And then I walk into the doctor's office. And so she sends me for a biopsy on the same day. And then when I come in for the result, I remember having a piece of paper in front of her. And for me, doctors always look serious in the UK. So I didn't see that as a sign of anything. And she looks at me and she goes, Shireen, it's cancer. And I didn't hear her. So I said, sorry, say it again. It's cancer. Say it again. It's cancer. 4 times maybe, until finally I broke down and I told her I haven't done finished what I want to do, and I started crying. And then she jumped in and told me, no, it's 90 to 100% treatable, and don't worry, and please, if you take anything from this, it's 90 to 100% treatable, but we don't know the extent of the cancer, we don't know the extent of the type of cancer for the treatment, so you need to wait a week while the biopsy results come out, but already I can tell you you're going to have chemo. I'm like, oh my God. That was my second shock, and my heart dropped to the ground. I'm like, you want to poison me? She's like, no, I want to cure you. And I don't know what happened. I think that moment, it would be best explained. I felt like the ground had opened up and I just dropped inside. And I was aware of things around me, but I couldn't, I almost felt I couldn't breathe. and I couldn't move almost. And that's how shocked I was, total shock. And I remember leaving the doctor's office, and I remember going to the lift, and you know, sometimes, and then there was a waiting room on the right side of the lift. So, and I saw a patient from the far end as I'm waiting for the lift to come. And I saw the patient had no hair on her head, no eyebrows, no eyelashes. And I froze in front of the lift because I thought, this is the preview to my future. And I think in essence, what scared me to death wasn't just the realization, it was the pain that could be associated with the treatment. That's what scared me really. And I just froze, and I had to be told by my then ex-husband, at the time he was my husband, now we're divorced, but I had to be told to get into the lift because I couldn't move. You know, I don't think I was, and today I think, I really hope she didn't think I was staring at her, but because I went blank. So that's what it was like.
Difficult. So you're telling us about your experience and what you felt. I mean, do you feel that you relive it every time you tell it? How do you feel when you tell the story?
You know, that's the funny thing. I think, you know, it's a little bit of both. It depends which part of the story that I remember or which part of the phase that I actually remember. But lately, it feels like the more I actually tell the story, because I know it's going towards a cause. So it feels like the more that I'm actually, shedding light on the story, it makes me feel a little lighter. It makes me feel like the psychological healing of after you finish your physical hearing and thank God you're cancer free, that psychological healing that you need to heal yourself, I feel you get a little lighter once you push through the boundaries of first talking about it. Because when you first talk about it the first two times, it's a bit emotional. And I'm not saying you don't feel the emotions before, like later on, but it's more of a thankful kind of emotions that, you know, maybe my experience, hopefully, will encourage other women to know that it's okay to be fragile. It's okay not to have things worked out. And please do best and test.
Well, that's a powerful message. I'd like to ask you next about when you were going off through all this, what was the hardest moment?
Yeah, the hardest moment. Okay. So basically the hardest moment, there was many hard moments. So it's a little bit difficult for me to totally phrase the hardest moment, but I felt there was a series of hard moments. One of the hard moments I felt was that this happened, you know, it happened on 13th of December, 2019. And which meant that COVID came right after. And so I was going for my chemo treatment and the two operations and radiotherapy, but the chemo treatment and the two operations definitely in the COVID London lockdown. And that for me proved quite tough. I remember basically, you know, going in for the operation, and I remember not being able to bring a family member, anybody, from the front of the hospital, Princess Grace Hospitals, where I did it. And you know, so my brother and my family drops me off on the front, and then I have to walk in on my own. And I have to be alone through the 2-3 days while they prep me for the surgery. And I have to be alone when the anesthesia guy comes to me. And the hardest moment, I think, was when the head nurse came to take me to the operation, and they walk you to the operation when it's COVID, and they ask you to put on your mask, and you're already scared, and then he walks you into the operation room, and then I see a round of doctors, all like, I mean, you're COVID, you're tested with to make sure you don't have COVID before they allow you to enter the hospital anyway, but they're all covered, and there is a round of, like, I don't know, between nurses and doctors, I don't know, like, I walked into 8 people, and you walk straight, and I'm walking slowly, and then you get to the bed, and you get to utensils around you, and you look up, and it's like it's in the basement, and it's a surgery room, and that's when I lost it. I got up on the step. I was meant to get up onto the bed, and I just burst out crying. I thought, my God, this is it. And then And I just could not stop crying. They turned around. They all comforted me. And then I went forward. But I think that was really scary. It scared me quite a lot. That move was just, it just scared me.
Well, it would scare me too, Shireen. So for those who don't know in the audience, and maybe everyone knows, Shireen has also, used art to, I guess you, is art kind of a therapy for you, has used art as an emotional release to what's to her, what she experienced. And I noticed in two of your paintings, Shireen, there's a white butterfly. Tell us a little bit more. What does the white butterfly symbolize?
Okay. Okay. So basically for me, after I was pronounced, thank God, cancer free and everything. And then one day, it wasn't an immediate thing. So I was speaking to my therapist who deals with pre and post cancer patients. And it's not really to deal necessarily with talking about cancer, but how to move on from the experience and discussing anything at all you'd like. So, and I was just talking naturally and I found out and I told her, you know what? Just recently, this is a couple of months ago, I told her, I just feel like I want to draw about what I went through, but I'm not an artist, but maybe I should be writing about it considering that's what my, it's not magazine just publishing that I love to write because I write thrillers and I've published thrillers and usually words are the way I, express myself. And I told her, but for some reason, I don't know, casually over the phone, I told her, I don't know, but I may want to do art. She's like, just go with the feeling. She's like, it doesn't matter. See where it takes you. It make you feel a lot better. And then one painting turned into two, turned into three. I was just having fun, honestly, with colors and everything. And then it's only until I reached the seventh painting that I suddenly looked back, looked at what I created, and I realized I'm telling my whole story through a series of paintings. So I'm going from diagnosis, the horrifying shock of finding out, to the treatment with several paintings, to the recovery, and then to the future, looking into the future and, inspirational quotes that you can put together. And so for me, the inspirational, for me, I finally understood. It took me time for me to understand. I want to make it clear that while you're going through the cancer, it was quite difficult for me to handle all my emotions or to direct myself beyond doing the chemo or beyond the treatment I had to do. I felt some of the times that I was a bit emotionally numb, or I would get panicked in certain points, or so I didn't have it all together in knowing the direction I wanted to take. It's only after I finished from it and I had time to myself that I was able to do this. And basically looking into the future, I remember, so when you, it, I finally understood that when you lose all your hair and you lose all your eyebrow hair and your eyelash hair, so it's pretty much your features and everything, it's you going back into your core. So it's like the butterfly. She's so beautiful and unique in her own colors and in her own patterns. But at the same time, and each butterfly is very different to another, at the same time, it's okay to lose all of that because the most important thing is in your center, in your core. And then you grow it back. And maybe you look a lot more beautiful than before because now you realize that this is like a transition. So for me, the idea that, yes, you may lose the features and you may lose what's on the outside, but on the inside, it's always there. And I don't know, maybe this had to happen. Maybe there was something that, some negativity, I'm talking about my personal account of it. Maybe there was some negativity under these layers that needed to go. So when I lost all of this, it was like a rebirth. And then coming back again, maybe I lost the negativity and I rebuilt on the understanding of different type of, I regrew the whole thing. So maybe for me, this is the way I made sense of it. So it's growing in a different aspect. So this is why there's butterflies, because butterflies, different colored butterflies, it's the gist of life, really, the gist of it, the sparkle of it, the flowers. That's why I put that into the future. So it's recreation and it's the beauty of all of that put together. It's the idea that anything is possible. Every butterfly is so different. So you can relish in this fact, and everything is possible, and everything can look so beautiful if you just, depending on how you, what your perspective is, basically.
Yeah, I like that I very much like the message that at the core, we should remember we're always the same. Doesn't matter what happens outside, we're always the same. I like that. Because sometimes, you know, things make us look at ourselves differently. I guess we shouldn't remember we're the same person. So many positive and powerful messages, but and maybe you have many more, but before we open the floor to the audience to ask questions, what would you like to tell them? What do you think is the most important thing you'd like to pass on to them?
I have to say there's three really important things. One of the most important things for me is do best in tests. Because if you can test early enough, you can't go wrong if you overtest. So if you can test early enough, you can nip it in the bud. You can really, like, you don't have to go through such aggressive treatment. You don't have to go through such life-altering changes or life-altering consequences as a result of discovering it a bit late. By the time I discovered it, it was grade 3 breast cancer. I think it's been with me. I've been told when they looked into the tumor for about 1 year and 8 months until I discovered it. I want to make it very clear that the lump doesn't grow at the beginning. For me, the lump came to the last 2 months of it. So it's really important to test. The second most important message for me, and I think this goes back to a personal point for me, is I can certainly, because once I got the diagnosis, I didn't want anybody to know that I had it beyond my family, and maybe I chose one or two friends, because I didn't feel I was strong enough to, because I was already facing this the next 6 or 8 or 9 months of uncertainty and fear and all this that you know, I had to climb that mountain. I had to climb that mountain to beat the cancer. I had no choice about it. And the thing is, when you have that kind of pressure, I couldn't want anybody else to know, because if they tell me, oh, you know, are you okay? And if are you fine? That could break me, because I'm mustering all the strength to do this. I wanted the compassion, but that kind of thing could really break me. So I didn't want people to know. So in that kind of way, I felt a little ashamed, not in the true sense of the word, but a little like I wanted to hide. Mm. You know what I mean? And this is why I can certainly is so important to me, because it speaks on a personal level to me. It shows me that I want people that have gone through cancer like me, or that are about to get diagnosed in cancer, to empower them their themselves, and to know that now they can own their cancer. So I look back and I say, if I've been on this struggle and I've went through it, that means I can do anything I set my mind on. I can certainly do anything I set my mind on, no matter how small it is, how big, or how in between. This helped me, empowered me to look at the past and think, you know what? This probably all happened for the best. Because I would have never reached this kind of conclusion in the same way. Maybe I really, truly needed to understand what it meant. And maybe this is why I went on this journey. So, and the third thing is, there is a lot of noise in today's world. So we just need to be careful that some of it is positive, some of it is negative, but the most important thing is to, you know, go to the beat of your own drum. Listen to others, join people that want to beat to that drum too, that have different point of music to share with you and all of this. But don't berate yourself a lot, because it will come out and it will harm you in the end.
Well, I really, you're a role model to us all. Everything you've been through and to come out so much stronger, really a role model. I wish we could all be the same. Oh, look, and Asil has put a heart for you. Well, so before we open the floor for questions and comments, I will now stop the recording.